friends, welcome to this Dhamma on Air number 99 special on the full moon day of May, Vesak day, the most holy day for all Buddhists. Nama Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. On this full moon night of May, approximately 2,500 years ago, the Buddha awakened, "May all beings gain advantage and bliss by celebrating this very Vesak day, which celebrates both the birth, enlightenment, and passing away of the Buddha Gautama, because they are all the Buddhas are born enlightened and dies on this very full moon day, which usually falls in May. This full moon day also celebrates the birth. This full moon day also celebrates the Buddha's third visit to Sri Lanka in the 8th year after his enlightenment, where he went to Kelaniya in the invitation of the Naga king Manyakika, and also celebrates the crowning of the Kevanam, the king Devanampiyatissa. Tissa, liked by the Devas, and the laying of the foundation stone of the Mahastupa here in Sri Lanka in the ancient sacred northern city of Anuradhapura. And this is all information from the Mahavamsa, the great chronicle of the island. What follows is a report about the great enlightenment of the Buddha. This exceedingly rare Sammasambodhi event, which can happen as rarely as 1 in 50 to 60 universal cycles, aeons or kalpas, each lasting 150 billion years, which entails there can be more than 1 trillion years between these Sammasambodhi events. This is enough to gain certainty that this is a worthy day to celebrate, because it is really, really exceedingly rare. So please remember, at this very full moon day in May, the Blessed Buddha awakened by completely perfect, utterly unsurpassable self-enlightenment. And this is a story he told about it himself, as it is embedded in the canonical Jataka Nidana, which is a text from the intro text to the Jatakas, the 547 birth stories we have in the Buddhist Bible, in 3 volumes, but this is a thin volume one can buy for oneself, which is called The Story of Gautama Buddha, and it's printed by the Palitech Society of London in 1990, and it is very well translated by the late Professor Emeritus N.A. Jayavikrama, professor in Pali, here in Sri Lanka. And the story goes like this. The great enlightenment of the Buddha, Sammasambodhi. At that time, a girl named Sujata Senani lived in Uruvela. When adult, she prayed before a certain banyan tree that she might get a husband equal to herself in caste, and that her firstborn baby may be a son. If so happened, she promised to offer the perceived deity in the tree the value of 100,000 gold pieces yearly. Her wishes and prayers were successful, since so indeed did it happen. 6 years after that, the Buddha-to-be had started his severe asceticism, since he decided to pay back the perceived deity. She came on the full moon day on the month of Vesak. First, she put 1,000 cows on good grass in the forest. The milk from them she fed to 500 cows. And the milk from these 500 cows she gave to 250 cows. And so on down to feeding such ultra pure milk from 16 cows to 8 cows. This process was at that time called working the milk in and in, making the milk more sweet, thick, protein rich and nutritious. At the full moon day of Vesak, she rose at early dawn, before daybreak, and herself milked the cows. As soon as the new buckets were placed under the cows, the milk poured forth in streams spontaneously, all by itself. Seeing this wonderful miracle, Sujata collected the milk herself in a new pot and began to cook the milk rice, the kiribat. Seeing the milk boil immediately while rotating with large bubbles, yet not spilling over, and the fire burn without a trace of smoke, she knew something very special was going on. When Sujata saw so many miracles appear, she said to her servant girl, Punya, "Punya, dear girl, the tree deity is very well disposed towards us today. Never have I seen so many wonders. Run quickly to the holy tree and get everything clean, neat and ready." "Yes, my lady," answered the girl, and ran in hot haste to the foot of the tree. Now on that very night, the future Buddha had 5 specific dreams that made him conclude, after thorough consideration, "Certainly, without doubt, today is the very day I will reach enlightenment." When the night had passed, he cleaned himself and came early before dawn to the very tree and sat down facing east to wait the suitable time for going begging round. His 5 colored radiance illuminated the entire tree. Then Punya came. When she saw this streaming radiance from his body lighten up the entire tree in a golden, shimmering color, she became highly excited and said to herself, "Our deity, methinks, have come down from the tree and has seated himself in order to perceive and receive our offering with his own hands." So she ran in great speed back to Sujata and told all about it. When Sujata, meaning well-born, heard this news, she became both thrilled and jubilant. So elated, she rewarded the slave Punya by saying, "From this very day, you may be here as my eldest daughter," and gave Punya all such jewelry appropriate for that position. Since all the Buddhas on the day of their Buddhahood received their food on a golden dish, the idea occurred to Sujata to put the milk rice on a golden plate worth 100,000. The milk rice poured out from the pot as water from a lotus leaf and filled exactly the golden dish, covering it with another golden dish and wrapping it in a white cloth. She adorned herself with all her jewelry and ornaments, and proceeded with a dish on her head to the foot of the banyan tree. As soon as she caught sight of the future Buddha, she became exceedingly overjoyed and ecstatic. Expecting him to be the tree deity, she approached slowly while constantly bowing. She took down the golden dish from her head and uncovered it. Advancing slowly close to the Buddha-to-be, she put down a golden vase with a flower-scented water first. Sujata then placed the golden plate directly in the hands of the great being. He gazed at her, and she perceived that he was a holy man. Doing a reverential obeisance, touching with feet, knees, elbows, hands, and forehead the ground, she said, "Lord, please accept my donation and take wherever you see fit," adding, "May your wishes come true, just like mine." She then raised and departed as disinterested in her golden plate as had it been a withered leaf. The future Buddha then raised and circulating the tree rightwise, he proceeded down to the Niranya River and descended into its waters, just as many thousands of future Buddhas before him had here bathed on the very day of their complete self-enlightenment. This place is even today a pilgrimage place called Subhadipitta, the place of the bathing. Coming out of the water, he dressed in the simple hempen dress of saintship, also common to all the noble bodhisattvas before him. Sitting down on the bank, he then rolled the entire dish of thick, sweet milk rice into 49 small balls and then ate these pellets one by one. Thereafter, he took no further food. In all the 49 days of the 7 weeks, he spent enraptured in the bliss of awakening. During all that time, the Buddha neither bathed, rinsed his mouth, nor eased himself, but was fully absorbed into the ecstasy of the trance of arahantship. When he had consumed the milk rice, he took the golden dish and said, "If I am to become a Buddha today, let this golden dish go upstream." He then threw it into the water, and cleaving the stream as a freed horse, it went upstream in the middle of the river for 160 meters. Then suddenly it dived into a whirlpool and sank into the submerged palace of the Black Snake King, where it hit click-clack, click-clack against the top of the stack of golden dishes used by the three prior Buddhas before him in this aeon. When the Black Snake King heard this particular sound, then he exclaimed, "Yesterday another Buddha lived, today a new one has been born," repeating several hundred admiring verses. Such is the time from yesterday in this immense time lapse of 576 million years between two Buddhas appeared to him. At this rare occasion, he raises his body up into the air to several kilometers of height. Then the future Buddha rested at the riverbank between the thal trees in full bloom. at nightfall when the flowers closed. He raced like a lion and went down to the Bodhi tree along a path prepared by the devas. Just then a grass cutter came going with his harvest from the other side. He offered the great being 8 handfuls of kusa grass. When he saw that the sage in front of him was a holy man, the future Buddha accepted the grass and proceeded to the foot of the Bodhi tree. There the expert of the world surveyed the saint, surveyed the sight standing on the southern side. This instantly sank down while the opposite side raised up. So he said, this cannot be the site for attainment of supreme wisdom. So he went around the tree to the western and northern side, but also there did the ground sink down. Reaching the imperturbable eastern side, the eastern side, where all the Buddhas take their seat, he sat down saying to himself, this is indeed the immovable spot where all the Buddhas have planted themselves before me. This is the very place for destroying the net of passion. And shaking out the grass, it spontaneously arranged itself into a suitable and symmetric seat. Then the future Buddha turned his back to the trunk and faced east. And right there and then he made this mighty decision. Let just blood and flesh of this body dry up, and let skin and the sinews fall from the bones. I will not leave this seat before having attained the absolute supreme wisdom. So determined did he seat himself in this unconquerable seat, which not 100 strikes of lightning could make him waver from. At this very same moment, the rebel deity Mara, the evil one, raised, exclaiming, Prince Siddhartha will pass beyond my power, but I will never allow it. And sounding the Mara's washout, he prepared his army and went out for battle. The sound was like a rumbling roar of an earthquake. Mara mounted his enormous elephant carrying many different weapons. Not two in his army carried the same weapon, and this immense mass of warriors swept as a flood to or overwhelmed the blessed Bhagava. Their deities and the 1,000 worlds, devas of this galaxy, were singing the praises of the great being. Mahabrahma was holding a white umbrella, but when Mara's army came close, no one dared stay put. They all fled, trembling like a caught rabbit. The black Naga King dived into the earth, and reaching his deep hidden home, he covered his face with both his hands and lay down. Sakka, the king of the 33 devas, threw the conch right over his shoulder with both hands and lay down. And he took up a safe position at the rim of the solar system. Mahabrahma left the white umbrella at the end of this galaxy and fled into his fine material plane. Not a single deity was able to stand his ground. So they all left the great being sitting calmly, all alone, only protected by the consummation of his 10 mental perfection, the Dasa Parami. Then Mara said to his militia, this Siddhartha, son of King Suddhodana, is far greater than any other man, so we will never succeed to fight him up front. We will therefore attack him from behind. Looking towards the north, the kinsmen of the sun then perceived Mara's army was approaching like a great roaring flood and noted, here comes this mighty gang putting up their forceful power against me alone. Neither my parents nor friends are here. But I have all these great accumulated perfections right at my side, embedded in my mind. These mental perfections will be my shield and the force of probability that will crush this mighty evil and armed gathering. And so he remained all still, inwardly focusing on the 10 great perfections, wanting to drive away the future Buddha. Mara then whirled up a great storm, which could tear away mountain peaks, uproot trees, and pulverize entire cities into scattered powder. Yet this immense show of energy, when it reached the future Buddha, it could not even make the corner of his rope flutter. So was the power of the great beings, long, long, long accumulated merit and karma, probability, stacked up, intending then to drown this bull among the seers. Mara caused a great rain to pour down, and it rained and it rained and it rained, until the wild torrents of water flooded even the treetops. But on reaching the future Buddha, this immense flood, this tsunami, could not even wet his robe to the extent of a dewdrop. Infuriated, Mara, yielding the power over even the creation of others, then caused a showering of bombardment of flaming rocks and smoking boulders. Yet these turn into celestial flowers when reaching the great being. So also did a veritable assault by a cascade of burning spears, swords, arrows, and axes hurling through the air. Now fully enraged, Mara then whirled forth an attack of burning red coals. These, however, also fell gently as flowers at the feet of the foremost of all humans. Now seething mad, Mara then tried white ashes and sand, glowing like fire, but this fell as sandalwood powder at the feet of the caravan leader. A shower of moiling blood became a delighting balm. Now feverishly attempting to frighten the great cedar, Mara then caused a dense fourfold darkness to spread out. But reaching the very dispeller of darkness, it disappeared like darkness it lighted up by the radiance of the morning sun. In despair, frustrated, being unable even to touch the wielder of power with these 9 mighty hurricanes of wind, rain, rocks, weapons, red coals, hot ashes, sand, mud, and darkness, Mara, somewhat now in panic, commanded his army. "Why do you stand still? Seize, kill, drive away this prince." Armed with a discus, he drew near the future Buddha on his elephant and yelled, "Siddhartha, leave this seat. It is not yours, but it is mine." Hearing this, the welcome one replied, "Mara, neither have you fulfilled the 10 perfection to the 3rd degree, nor have you ever given the 5 grave donations, the 5 grave offers. Neither has you striven for insight for the welfare of the world, nor for enlightenment. Therefore does this seed not belong to you, but indeed to me." Unable to control his fury, the enraged Mara then hurled the discus, which could cut stone pillars like bamboo shoot. But as a great being reflected on the perfection, it changed into a canopy of flowers when approaching him, which remained suspended over his head. Mara's armor then threw enormous mountain-like boulders, saying, "This surely will make him get up and flee." But they also fell to the ground as flowers, Meanwhile, the gods were standing on the rim of the world and craning their necks to see. They mumbled, "Oh, what a day, what a day. This handsome prince will certainly get smashed. What will he do to save himself?" The conqueror then confidently continued, "Mara, who is your witness to have given these great donations?" Mara responded, "As many as you see here." And instantly, all in his army roared, "I'm his witness, I'm his witness," as with one voice. Mara then asked the great being, "Siddhartha, who is your witness to have given these great donations?" The future Buddha then answered, "You have alive witnesses at your side, while I have none. However, the great sevenfold donation which I gave at my existence as Vesantara shall now be testified by this great earth, how inanimate she may be." And at the exact moment he touched the earth with his hand, it erupted into a tremulous earthquake. When he gladly remembered his prior great donation, Mara's elephant then crouched down before him on its knees, and suddenly, overpowered by metaphysical fear, Mara's followers fled helter-skelter in all directions. Not two went the same way, but leaving their weapons in a chaos all behind. They fled terrified by panic created by their own evilness. Seeing them flee, the great assembly of deities triumphantly shouted, "Mara is defeated! Prince Siddhartha has won! Let us celebrate the victory!" The Nagas urged the Nagas, the birds urged the birds, the snakes urged the snakes, the deities urged the deities, the Brahma urged the Brahmas, and they all approached the great wisdom seat of the Supreme Teacher, carrying perfumes, flowers, garlands, and offering, while they sang, "The victory has this illustrious Buddha won. The evil one, the Endmaker, is defeated and done." Thus they jubilantly circled the wisdom throne, and the band of snakes singing their praises of the seer, the flocks of birds singing their praises of the sage, and the assembly of devas and deities singing their praises of the conqueror, the group of Brahmas singing their praises of the worthy one. It was just before sun had set that the Tathagata had thus conquered Mara and defeated his army. Then at the same night, while the Bodhi rained red sprigs on his robe, the consummate one acquired knowledge of the previous existences in the first watch of the night. With the mind thus concentrated, purified, bright, fixed, unified, focused, tractable, compliant, steady, and imperturbable, I directed to the remembrance of my past life. I recollected numerous past life. One birth, two, five, 10, 50, 100, 1,000, 100,000, many eons of cosmic contraction and many eons of cosmic expansion, many eons of cosmic contraction, Big Bang, Big Crunch, and expansion. There I had such a name, belonged to such a clan and species, had such a body, such was my food, such was my experience of pleasure and pain, and such was the end of my life. Passing away from that state, I re-arose there. There I have such a name, belonged to such a family and species, had such a form, Such was my food, such my experience of pleasure and pain, and such was the end of my life. Passing away from that later state, I re-arose here. Thus I remembered my various past lives in all their various modes and details. This was the first knowledge I attained in the first watch of the night. Ignorance was thus destroyed. Knowledge arose. Certainty was won. Darkness was destroyed. Light arose. As happened in one who is mindful, keen, and determined. But the pleasant feeling that arose in this way did not evade my mind, nor did it remain. With the mind thus concentrated, purified, bright, intact, pliant, malleable, steady, and imperturbable, I now directed it to the knowledge of the passing away and reappearance of beings. I saw by means of the divine eye, the Dipa Chakku, purified and surpassing the human eye, I saw beings passing away and reappearing. And I realized how and why they are high and low, beautiful and ugly, fortunate and unfortunate, all in accordance with the karma of their prior actions. These beings who were endowed with bad behavior of body, speech, and mind, who reviled the noble ones, held wrong views, and acted and behaved under the influence of these wrong views, with the break up of the body, right after their death, they have all reappeared in the plane of misery, in bad destinations, the lower realms, even in hell. However, these beings, these fine beings, who are gifted with good behavior of body, speech, and mind, who did not revile the noble ones, who held right views, and acted, behaved under the influence of these right views, with the breakup of the body, right after death, they have all reappeared in a happy destiny, even in the divine worlds. Thus, by means of the divine eye, purified and surpassing by far the human eye, I saw beings passing away and reappearing, and I differentiated how they are high and low, beautiful and ugly, fortunate and unfortunate, all in accordance with their particular mixture of good and bad karma. This was the second knowledge I attained in the second watch of the night. Again, ignorance was destroyed. Knowledge arose. Certainty emerged. Darkness was destroyed. Light arose. As happens in one who is mindful, aware, keen, and determined. But the satisfaction that arose in this way did not evade my mind, nor did it remain. With the mind thus concentrated, absorbed, bright, purified, pliant, malleable, steady, and fully attained to imperturbability, I directed it to the knowledge of the ending of the mental fermentations, the asava. I realized then how it actually comes to be, how it actually is conditioned, how it actually is linked causally that caused by ignorance, mental construction emerges. Ceasing of ignorance therefore ceases mental construction. Caused by mental construction, consciousness emerges. And thus ceasing of mental construction therefore ceases consciousness. Caused by consciousness, name and form emerges. Ceasing of the very same consciousness therefore ceases naming and forming. Caused by naming and forming, name and form, body and mind, the six senses emerge. Ceasing of name and form therefore ceases the six senses. Caused by these six senses, these six inputs, contact emerges. Ceasing of the six sense input therefore ceases all contact. Caused by contact, feeling emerges. Ceasing of this sense contact therefore also ceases feeling. Caused by feeling, craving, tanha emerges. So ceasing of the feeling therefore also ceases craving. Caused by craving, clinging emerges, which entails that ceasing of that very craving therefore also ceases that consequent clinging. Caused by clinging, becoming emerges. Ceasing of this tenacious clinging therefore ceases becoming. Caused by this process, this drive of becoming, birth emerges. Birth of the moment. Birth of the life. Birth of the baby. Ceasing of becoming therefore ceases birth. Caused by birth to aging, sickness, decay and death emerge. So ceasing of this birth, this appearance, this emergence, therefore ceases all aging, all sickness and all death, whether of the moment, the body or the life. Caused by this aging, sickness, decay and death, misery emerges. Suffering comes to be. So ceasing of this aging, sickness and decay and death therefore ceases all misery and thereby silences all suffering. Right there and forever. So seeing, so is suffering. So is the cause of suffering. So is the end of suffering. And so is the noble eightfold way leading to the end of suffering. Such was the mental fermentation. Such is the cause of this mental fermentation. Such is the end of this mental fermentation. And such is the noble eightfold way leading to the very end, irreversible end of all mental fermentation. When my mind saw that, realized that, it was freed from the fermentation of sensuality. It was released from the fermentation of becoming. It was unobstructed by the fermentation of ignorance. With this release, there was the knowledge released. And right there, I realized that birth is ended. This holy, noble life is fulfilled, is completed. The mission has come to an end. There's no further state of being in this cosmos. This was the third knowledge I attained in the third watch of the night. Ignorance was finally destroyed. Certainty arose. Darkness was destroyed. Light arose. As it happens to one who is mindful, aware, keen, and determined. But the satisfaction that so arose did not obsess my mind, nor did it remain. At this very moment of omniscience, the state of knowing all, the 10,000 worlds quaked 12 times and became gloriously adorned. Throughout this galaxy, flowering trees bloomed, lotuses blossomed, and vines and trees bore fruit. In this synchrony, same time, the dark spaces of the hills and between the worlds became illuminated with a flood of radiance, surpassing even that of seven suns. Fully and perfectly enlightened, the Buddha, clearly perceiving this immense glory, spoke these two solemn verses, which has never been omitted by any of the countless thousands of prior Buddhas. And these two verses goes like this. Through this round of countless existences have I searched yet failed to find the Creator who framed this formation. What misery! Endless birth, death, suffering and pain. Now I see that the constructor, the creator, the building of the structure is craving. Never shall this construction be built again, as all the rafters are shattered and the main beam is busted and broken. At the full complete elimination of this craving, this mind has been released and reached rest. Then, friends, I myself, a subject to birth, aging, sickness, death, pain, sorrow and lamentation, mental degradation, having fully comprehended the danger in all what is subject to birth, aging, sickness, death, pain, sorrow, and mental degradation, searching the unborn, the unaging, the immune, the deathless, the unburning, the happy, pleasant, and pure supreme security from the oppressing bondage of craving, of becoming, of use, and of ignorance. I entered this unbecome, unborn, uncreated, unconstructed, undiverse, unformed, unchangeable, unconditional, unconditioned, unimaginable, undecaying, unaging, unending, undeceiving, universal unity. This supreme, safe, immune, deathless and painless state called Nibbana. This vision of certainty arose in me. This mental release is irreversible. This is the last birth. This endless reappearance is finally ended. Such was the supreme self-enlightenment of the Buddha Gautama. Worthy, therefore, is indeed this Vesak day, celebrating the birth, enlightenment, and passing away of the Buddha Gautama. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. May all beings, become thus happy on Vesak day, but hearing, knowing, understanding and rejoicing in that very event. Thank you and have a nice, noble, beautiful, worthy and reverential Vesak day. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Sammāyutta from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. As the next Buddha, the noble Arya Ajitamitaya, will say, you can come as you like, but you pay as you go. Thank you for your contribution and have a nice day.